Good, how are you?
Good. Welcome to the first Path to You.
Okay.
So, a little breakdown. I'll look at the camera for this. The Path to You is a little video, blog, podcast thing that I'll be doing that talks about how people got to where they are at this point in their life and go from there. So, I feel like you want to tell the people about yourself and what you do. And
sure. My name's Phil. I'm a filmmaker here in the San Francisco Bay Area. So I do mostly lighting for movies, and then after doing that for about a little over 10 years, I have a twin brother, and now we're both trying to direct our own movies.
So, cool.
Yeah.
So what's some of the stuff that you've worked on here? And then I know you used to live in LA too.
Yes. Yeah, I used to live in LA. The stuff that I've been working on here, mostly TV shows. So like I'll do commercials up here, mm-hmm. and then 13 Reasons Why season 1 and 2 I worked on, Sense 8,
mm-hmm.
and a couple other TV shows that come up here to the Bay Area to film.
Okay.
I'll work on. And then when I was in LA, I did a lot of independent films, so a lot of independent features, a lot of short films, occasionally a commercial or music video, but mostly narrative features.
Okay. And what made you transition from LA to here?
I'm from up here originally, and going to LA was always to learn, and it was always
mm-hmm.
going to be temporary.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was like, well, 6 months to a year, and then that turned into 6 years, and then it just kept going. And then moved back up here and got married and,
mm-hmm.
You know, realized that I actually want to live up here.
Mm-hmm.
But I was lucky enough to be able to travel a lot for work across the U.S. And overseas as well.
Mm-hmm.
So, I just felt like it was the right time for me to move back up here.
Yeah. And because you went to school up here.
Yes.
For college.
Yeah.
And then you decided to move to L.A. to learn and things like that.
Right.
Okay.
Exactly.
Is that what most people do? Like, L.A. is just kind of the hub where people go?
Yeah, L.A. is the hub.
Totally cool girl.
My wife is. Hey, you can be in the podcast later.
Yeah.
You know, LA is still, I mean, it's still Hollywood. So
mm-hmm.
It's where the best equipment is, it's where the best crews are, that's
mm-hmm.
sort of the, like, the gold standard.
Yeah.
But that being said, people are making movies all over the world now.
Mm-hmm.
And with technology, and not just camera technology, but lighting technology, you can get really good equipment all over the world.
Yeah.
And really good crews all over the world.
Okay. And so how did you get to this point? How did you know that you wanted to work in film? How did you choose this path?
it's interesting to think about. I mean, I knew at a very young age that I wanted to make movies.
Mm-hmm.
I must have been in, like, the first grade or something, and I decided that I was going to make movies. We grew up in Oakland, and my aunt lived across the street from us. And when I say us, it's usually me and my twin brother. We also have a younger brother. Anytime, like, my parents needed to go out or whatever, then we would go and stay at our Aunt Diana's, and she had a pull-out couch, and we would always watch the same movie. We would always watch The Goonies.
Nice.
And we just loved that movie.
Yeah.
But I remember there was one time where she said, oh, you know, the same person who did this also did Indiana Jones and Star Wars.
Oh.
And she was talking about Steven Spielberg, who didn't direct the movie, but he produced it.
Okay.
And we, you know, had grown up on Star Wars and Indiana Jones. And I remember thinking, wow, who is she talking about? And what does that mean to do a movie? Because whoever
mm-hmm.
that is, that's who I want to be when I grow up.
Mm-hmm.
And whatever that means, that's what I want to do.
Yeah.
So that was that moment that I decided, okay, I'm gonna do movies, whatever that means.
Okay.
So then I went to film school and then moved to LA, got a really good opportunity to work at a lighting company in LA,
mm-hmm.
and then I can trace every job back to that first job.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. And so your brother,
mm-hmm.
he's your twin.
Yes.
You both work in movies, you both kind of work in the same realm.
Mm-hmm.
Did he have that same light bulb moment?
He did, and I'm not sure exactly what his moment was, but he also had a similar, you know, thing where he realized, oh, I think because he was maybe thinking about being an actor first,
mm-hmm.
and this idea of, like, he could do all the careers in one career. He could be an astronaut, or be a scientist, or be a detective, or whatever. I think that was part of it. But yeah, we both sort of independently came up with the idea that we wanted to work in movies,
mm-hmm.
and then realized that, and we're like, okay, well, let's work in movies together.
Yeah.
Great.
Cool.
Yeah, it's been easy.
And so, you guys do a lot of work together. Do you ever do work separately?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So I am a gaffer by trade.
Okay.
And for a lot of people who don't know, a gaffer is somebody who is in charge of the lights.
Okay.
My brother is a key grip by trade, who, you know, everyone likes those terms, gaffer and key grip, and it's sort of a similar thing. Grips are hard to explain. They help all the departments. They
mm-hmm.
help everybody, but they mostly deal with like the hardware, like
okay.
like the electric side, the lighting side. We have to put the light up on the roof or up on this wall. I want
mm-hmm.
a light up here to light the actor.
Mm-hmm.
The grips figure out how to mount that light up there.
Okay.
So I like to equate it to the rhythm section. It's like drums and bass.
Okay.
Two separate instruments, but
yep.
they're both the rhythm section.
Right.
Same thing with gaffer and key grip and the electrics and the grips.
Mm-hmm.
Up here in the Bay Area, I grip and Joe grips, because
mm-hmm.
we are transitioning into making our own movies.
Right.
So,
how do you make that transition into?
I'm still trying to figure that out. It's funny. It feels very much like a complete career change.
Interesting.
Even though it's the same industry and it's the same, you know, it's because a part of it is convincing yourself that you can direct.
Mm-hmm.
Part of it is convincing other people that you can direct.
Mm-hmm.
The hard thing is it's hard to find work as a director. It's easier to find work as a grip
mm-hmm.
because you have, you know, we had a grip crew on 13 Reasons. The standard grip crew was maybe like 10 or 12 people total,
okay.
Plus, you know, 5 or 6 extra grips.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of grips, but there's only one director.
Mm-hmm.
And so that is the hardest thing. And I think personally it's hard to, you get the calls to work on a movie as a crew member,
mm-hmm.
and it's hard to say no to that because
mm-hmm.
you don't know when your next call is going to be.
Right.
You know, it's very job to job.
Yeah.
So it's hard to go from being the one who works to get paid
mm-hmm.
to being the one who is asking people to work and paying
mm-hmm.
those people to work.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're making, if you're and especially people starting out, the only thing that they can do is to, you know, make their own films.
Right.
You know, so they're like, okay, I have an idea for a short film. I've saved up this money. I'm going to, you know, hire my friends as crew members, and
mm-hmm.
so I have to pay them.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I think it feels very much like a complete career change or almost like starting over.
Okay.
But, you know, for me it's worth it because it's... you know, it's hard to get a taste for that, to make your own film,
mm-hmm.
and then to go and work for a year on somebody else's movies.
Right.
You know, it's hard to go into that and do 110% like you like to do as a crew member.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the people who trained me as a crew member taught me, you know, to take pride in what I do
mm-hmm.
and to do the best job that you can,
mm-hmm.
you know, to set the flag how it needs to be set, or set the light how it needs to be set,
right.
you know. Not to half-ass it, but to do it properly.
Mm-hmm.
To run the cable so it looks nice and neat, to
mm-hmm.
tie the knots so that they're nice and neat, or whatever
mm-hmm.
it is.
Mm-hmm.
Partially because that makes it safe,
right.
but also because that's, like, you're doing a craft, and you need to put that love and attention into that craft.
Mm-hmm.
So it's hard to, I think, go in and do 110% while you're wanting to, you know, go direct or to be the one who is creative.
Right.
So.
And so, so many questions that have come to my mind. I'll get to the movie question later. How did you decide your trade, and how did you get into the trade? When you went to film school,
right.
Do you pick a trade within the film school, or is it just kind of like when you're an electrician?
Some people do. What I did, and I think Joe also did the same thing, our goal was always to make our own movies.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we always wanted to be directors. When we were younger, we were like, who makes movies? Well, movie studios. Okay, well, we need to start a movie studio.
Mm.
Okay, so let's start a movie studio.
Mm-hmm.
But what do you need in a movie studio? Well, you need a camera, you need some lights,
mm-hmm.
you need, props and wardrobe and all
mm-hmm.
that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were very impatient, especially in college, you know, you're a poor college student.
Yeah.
And we realized it's like, well, a decent camera costs thousands of dollars.
Right.
And it's not just the camera, it's the lenses, and it's the
mm-hmm.
batteries, and
mm-hmm.
it's the tripod, and it's all this stuff just
yeah.
to get the camera to work.
Mm-hmm.
But I can buy a light and use it instantly.
Right.
And so we ended up buying, because we were too impatient to save up the thousands of dollars to buy a whole camera package,
mm-hmm.
we bought some lights first.
Okay.
You know, a couple hundred dollars, should we buy a light here or a stand here or whatever, and we could use it right away.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, we took classes with cameras, we learned how to use cameras, we learned how to use lights, and the lighting was always, I think because it's so direct, because we also did some sound too, you know,
mm-hmm.
you try everything in film school,
mm-hmm.
Which is the beauty of film school, so you can find what you like,
right.
And the application of lighting I always found to be the most exciting, probably because
mm-hmm.
it's the one that you can see,
mm-hmm.
you know, there's a quicker ratio of cause and effect that you can see. You turn on a light, you see the light is shining on the wall, or the shadow that's casting,
mm-hmm.
or whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even though a lot of people gravitated towards camera, there's only one camera, but there's all these lights.
Mm-hmm.
And so, so that sort of started in film school. And then I got an internship at Moll Richardson,
mm-hmm.
which is a lighting company, the oldest lighting company in Hollywood, and went down there and started learning how to light, and I just really fell in love with lighting.
Cool.
So then that sort of got me on the path to be a gaffer.
Mm-hmm.
And then a few years ago, you know, we decided to make, well, yeah, a few years ago, we were like, well, you know, let's, my brother bought a hostess tray
mm-hmm.
and a car mount. So it's different camera mounts that you can mount onto cars,
right.
To get different sort of shots.
Mm-hmm.
And so he bought one, and because we ended up buying some equipment, so he bought that to put in with our equipment. I said, okay, well, I'll match you, and I'll put in the same money, but let's make a short film.
Mm-hmm.
So we made a little tiny, you know, 4-minute short film.
Mm-hmm.
And because we sort of realized, it's like, well, no one's going to pick us out on set and be like, you guys look like you could direct, or you can, you know.
Yeah.
We needed to make our own content,
mm-hmm.
to then show people, hey, yes, we can make,
yeah.
we can make films.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's this, I guess, sort of a roundabout way of answering your question, where
mm-hmm.
I just sort of fell into lighting, but then
mm-hmm.
Decided to shift gears.
Yeah.
You know.
And so you've made a number of shorts, or how many have you made?
Yeah, we've made maybe 4 or 5 of our own short films, and then we've helped produce a bunch of little tiny independent features.
Okay.
And then we just made our first feature that's our own, that we've owned completely, we fundraised for, we found the script, we found the actors, we did it all ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
That Joe directed, my twin brother Joe directed, and I produced, and then my sister-in-law, Joe's wife, Mandy, who's like a real producer,
mm-hmm.
also produced. I would just sort of fake my way through it. So we made our first feature, we shot it maybe 3 years ago or so.
Oh, wow.
And we're actually just releasing it on Amazon.
Yeah, I saw that.
Father's Day 2018.
Cool.
So.
And what's the storyline behind that? And how did you find the script?
So that's, it's a drama. We got that through, we were in development for a Western that sort of, the budget on, that it would take to make that movie, how we wanted to make that movie just ballooned out of control into like a $5 million epic.
Right, right.
And we realized, well, you know, as first-time filmmakers, first-time feature filmmakers,
right, right,
even though we had been working in the industry for like 10 years at that point, nobody was going to give us that money to make our first feature.
Yeah, like Westerns, so, you can't do for
right,
a small
exactly.
Amount.
You're in the middle of nowhere. You can't,
yeah.
You know, so...
costumes.
Right,
and
yeah,
and,
exactly.
Yeah.
And so then we sort of had to table that project, and an actor friend of ours, who's the lead actor in the movie, wrote this movie.
Oh, cool.
to star in.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, hey, you know, I know that you guys aren't doing the Western anymore, but I have a script if you're interested in making this. And so we read it and saw a movie that was doable,
mm-hmm.
You know. We knew that we can make it for a certain amount of money and that was much easier to fundraise for.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's how we ended up finding that project. And I'm it's really interesting looking back on it now, because like it's in some ways it's hard for me to watch, and I think that everyone is their own worst critic,
mm-hmm.
You know.
Sure.
Because I look at it, and of course, like I see all the mistakes that we made and the flaws and stuff. But I am really proud of how we made it, because we shot on film, we shot it in Colorado where it takes place.
Mm-hmm.
We had a blast driving out there with all of our friends as crew members and all of the friends who are actors.
Right.
Just driving through Colorado, making this little movie. It was
mm-hmm.
it was so much fun, you know. And even if, despite all the flaws, I'm still really proud of how we made it. Because we had a lot of people, you know, give us advice. They said, "Don't shoot on film. Shoot on digital. Don't shoot in Colorado.
Mm-hmm.
Shoot in LA.
Mm-hmm.
You know, shoot in California." And, you know, for better or for worse, we didn't listen to that advice, and we went out there, and we had a lot of fun doing it.
Yeah.
So
I mean, I saw the trailer. It looks beautiful.
Yeah. The story is, it's a drama
mm-hmm.
About a guy who is a roughneck. He lives in a small town in Colorado, and
mm-hmm.
he, you know, sort of lives a carefree sort of bachelor life,
right.
And he gets a knock on the door one day, and this woman shows up and says that he had a brother he didn't know about,
mm-hmm.
Who has just died.
Right.
And she complicates things even further by saying they were trying to have a baby, so would he help her
mm-hmm.
have a baby?
Mm-hmm.
It's a little bit of a slow burn kind
right.
of character piece.
Mm-hmm.
But we shot in some really cool locations, on a working oil rig,
mm-hmm.
in some really cool bars and restaurants,
mm-hmm.
in some amazing small towns in Colorado,
yeah.
You know, on the sides of these, you know, mountains and stuff. It was a lot of fun. It was really cool.
And so how long is that process? Like, do you go for months at a time, do you go back, or?
Well, the whole process of making a movie is like years.
Right.
Years.
You said that was 3 years ago that you
started. Yeah, it was like
yeah.
three or four. It, we probably got the script 4.5 years ago.
Wow.
You know, getting the script, and then you, like we worked with Brian to sort of tweak the script a little bit to make it easier to shoot
mm-hmm.
or more compelling, or, you know. And then you basically go into sort of like a development phase where you try to, get the funding, you try to, you know, secure as much as you can, get actors on board,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, you're kind of doing everything at the same time,
right.
to then find the money, and then we're able to raise the money through friends and family,
nice.
And then we went out there, we actually went out twice. The first time was maybe for 2 weeks total with travel, it was like 10 days or something like that,
okay.
And then the second time we went out for, the first time we went out was closer to, I guess 10 days. It was
okay.
like a week and a half. And then the next time we went out was for maybe like 3 weeks total with
mm-hmm.
travel.
Because mm-hmm.
It takes 2 days to drive out to Colorado
mm-hmm.
from California
mm-hmm.
and then to drive back. And then it took us months and months and months to edit the movie and to do the sound editing and
mm-hmm.
then to get the music.
Mm-hmm.
Once you get it all done, then you have to find a a place for it. So then we submit it to film festivals, and they played it at a couple of film festivals over the course of like a year and a half.
Okay.
And then trying to get it out there. So going through a distribution company.
Okay.
Which is a long like process, and we had a deal that we were working with a distribution company, but they really wanted us to change the look of the film, and to, because we're proud of the fact that we shot in film, so you can see the film grain. You know, it has sort of an older look to it, and they wanted us to clean all that up, and it just would have cost us like thousands and thousands of dollars, and sort of undid all the work that we had done while shooting the movie to get this look that we wanted.
Yeah.
So then we decided to just self-release on Amazon.
Cool.
So, yeah.
How does that work? And how did you even know that was a thing?
A couple producer friends of mine have released their films on Amazon. And it's a fairly simple process. All the same deliverables. So all, you know, the same, like, you know, various file formats and closed captioning and subtitles and all that you sort of need to go through their whole process.
Got it.
But it's a great resource to be able to get the film out there.
Yeah.
You know, and to because I feel like there are so many gatekeepers when it comes to getting any of your art or content out there.
Yeah.
You know, people who are deciding, is this good enough or is this not good enough? Mm-hmm. And that's one amazing thing about the internet and about streaming is that it allows the creator to have a little more control about getting their content out there.
Right.
Yes, there's more content to wade through. You know, I feel like we're just inundated with content through our phones, through our, you know, various streaming platforms, you know, that it's hard to keep up with it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's a whole other conversation.
Right.
But the flip side of that is that it's made the whole process a little more democratic,
right,
and made it more accessible for people.
Yeah. So what are your thoughts on like the straight to Netflix movies versus going to theaters?
It's interesting. I used to be very very sort of like rigid in my stance, you know, about movies versus TV, but I feel like those lines have been blurred now because of things like Netflix, and I think like HBO set the golden standard where they you know, they didn't need to worry about ad revenue, so they didn't have, their shows didn't have to be, you know, as PC or as, like, within this form, within this box.
Mm-hmm.
They could make some extreme content and take risks and be bold. And that is, you know, that's the same thing that Netflix and Amazon and Hulu are starting to do is be bold. And that, I think, is, that's one of my favorite phrases, you know. And I would tell that when a cinematographer or director would worry about the lighting and would want it to be, you know, oh, are we worried about how dark that is or how light that is or whatever. I would just try to encourage them and say, look, be bold. Nobody knows who you are. Nobody cares about you right now. Make something visual that stuns people. You know, whether people love it or hate it,
right,
at least they have a reaction to it.
Yeah.
So that to me is so exciting that that Netflix, you know, 5, 6, 10 years ago, a straight-to-TV movie would have been panned as like, oh, it's a straight-to-DVD, straight-to-TV movie.
Yeah.
Now you're getting, I mean, you're getting movie stars in these, you know, in these serialized shows.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like the platinum age now of television.
Right.
And it's funny because you almost can't even call it television anymore.
No.
It's just content, you know. They're making
streaming.
Yeah, you know, like you're making movies that you can stream. You're making mini series or long episodics that last for multiple seasons. It's a very exciting time, which is really cool. Like you know, because my dream had always been to make movies.
Mm-hmm.
My dream is to make movies for theaters, for the big screen.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't ignore all the different ways to make movies now.
Right.
You
know? Right.
That's and rather than worry about them, I try to embrace mm-hmm. all the different possibilities.
Right. Because if you don't embrace it, then you're left behind.
Right. And you limit yourself to, you know, I can only make feature films that come out in theaters. Well, I'm never going to make a movie then if mm-hmm. that, like, you know, you can't do that.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
You know, so it takes so much to get a movie into theaters right now.
Right.
That, you know, but if you want, you know, I'm not making movies for myself. I'm making movies to share for people
right.
to see.
Mm-hmm.
So I want them to be able to see it however they can see it.
Yeah.
You know, even if you upload something onto YouTube, you know, that is a place where people can see your content.
A lot of people.
Yeah.
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 So I think YouTube is one of the second most used search engines or something like that.
Right. Yeah, so. Exactly. Yeah, I do it myself. I'm like, oh, what's the name of that song? What's the name of this?
Mm-hmm.
It was with my daughter. I have a 1-year-old. And so if there's a song that I want, that I know that she'll dance to, so that
yeah.
I'm trying to distract her, I'll pull out my phone, I'll open up the YouTube app,
mm-hmm.
and I'll search for the song and press play, and there's,
yeah,
you know,
is.
There it is.
Or like 6 different versions of
right.
it.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
Cool.
So it's, you know... and it's obviously a double-edged sword because then
sure.
you have all sorts of content that you have to,
sort.
Yeah,
yeah,
you know, to find the right thing. But you know, I mean, that's everything.
Right.
Everything is pro and con.
I think it's so funny that you say that it's hard to get movies into the big screen when there are some really shitty movies out there that make it to big screen.
Yeah,
like,
but
how does that happen?
It costs so much money to get a movie into theaters.
Right.
And it has to do with the number of theaters that you're going to, the copies of the film that you have to make. I mean, because
mm-hmm.
you're no longer really making copies on actual film anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You're now making digital versions of it and uploading them and stuff. But, you know, and then a lot of the licensing. The theater needs to license the film because everything needs
mm-hmm.
to make money.
Right.
On top of that, you need people to know that this movie is going to be in theater, so they usually match the budget on the big studio movies, you know, whatever it costs to actually shoot the movie, they probably spend about the same to
wow.
advertise for it.
Yeah,
and then in order to make the money back with what they've spent, then
mm-hmm.
you need to of course have bankable movie stars in
right.
it. So you can't really do anything with an unknown to get into theaters
mm-hmm.
unless you're a, you know. A student Spielberg
or
you know, somebody who has that pull. It costs a tremendous amount. They spend a lot of money so that they can guarantee that money
mm-hmm.
comes back.
Got it. And so where does a lot of these places get their funding from? Like you said, you did it through friends and family, but if you want to make a big feature film, how do you go about getting that funding?
That is the $1 million, that's the multi-million-dollar question.
Okay.
Like where does the money come from? I mean, you know, there's a lot of production companies that have investor pools. You know, they have connections to investment companies that
okay.
invest in independent film.
Got it.
Yeah, you know, so if you're, but if you're, you know, if you live in the middle of Kansas or someplace, or, you know, even outside of LA, and
mm-hmm.
you have no connections to that, then you got to find a way to make the money for what you can get,
right.
you know,
right.
whether you do an Indiegogo or
mm-hmm.
Kickstarter kind of a thing,
mm-hmm.
there are now other online crowdfunding platforms
mm-hmm.
specifically for movies.
Oh, nice.
Like there's one of our favorites is Seed and Spark.
Okay.
And it's a film community, and then you can also release your film through Seed and Spark
oh,
as well.
Cool.
Yeah, Seed and Spark is really awesome. We did a short film called Bad Kids
mm-hmm.
that we fundraised through Seed and Spark, and then we were able to release it through there.
Nice.
So if you want to watch it, you log in, and you can watch it, and then a very
mm-hmm.
small percentage of that will go back to the filmmaker.
Oh, nice.
So it's a cool symbiotic relationship that helps,
mm-hmm.
You know, helps make a win for the filmmaker. You
mm-hmm.
know, I've made a movie, I've got distribution where people can see it,
mm-hmm.
and it's technically making money.
Mm-hmm.
Like those are all wins.
Yeah.
You know?
For sure.
even if it makes you $2, it's still a win, mm-hmm. you know. So.
Yeah. So, what was the name of the movie that's coming out on Father's Day?
It's called Searching for Fortune.
Searching for Fortune. Yeah. Okay.
Which I feel like we're all doing if we're in independent films.
<You know? laughs> That sounds about right.
Yeah.
What's next?
Also another good question. So my brother John and I have written a we've really spent this off time between since Searching Reason season 2 wrapped.
Mm-hmm.
We've really been focusing on writing. Mm-hmm. So we've written a grappa caper. It's like a heist caper movie that takes
cool.
place in Venice, Italy.
Okay.
That we're hoping will be our next film. There's also a zombie ambulance movie
okay.
that we wrote that hopefully will be one of our next film, or
yeah.
the film after that, which is a lot of fun. And
mm-hmm.
then there's you know, a handful of other films that we're in the process of writing or rewriting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's a couple of films that we want to make here in Oakland.
Mm-hmm.
You know, various genres. And but really... What the big takeaway that I realized from Searching for Fortune is that you really need to love the film that you're making because you're like there was a point in the post process that I was like, I hate this movie. I want to be done with it. I feel like you're raising a kid.
Yeah.
At some point, you know, my daughter's gonna annoy me and I'm gonna be like, please just go off to college.
Yeah.
Like, I cannot, you know,
yeah.
like that's what it's like because yeah. you were watching this movie thousands of times.
Right.
In the editing.
A short span of time.
Thousands of times. And you're just like, oh my God, I hate this song. Or,
yeah.
oh, I really hate how he said that. Or I really hate that shot.
Yeah.
Like, you know, and you're beating yourself up over this. There's things that nobody's ever going to notice, I'm sure.
Right.
You know. But I think that's part of the creative process in
mm-hmm.
general.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in between movies, I paint. Like I did
yeah.
this, and just to try to stay creative. And there's, you know, like I'm like, well, that like I should have done that better and that.
And
you
didn't recognize it until you said it.
Right. Like, so you know, so there are I think that's just very much part of the creative process. And then at a certain point, you get to the part where you're just like, oh my God, I just don't care anymore.
Yeah.
You know what? Forget it. Like, cause you, but right before that point, you're just like, I can't show this. Everyone's gonna laugh at me. Everyone's
mm-hmm.
gonna, you know, I can't put this up.
Mm-hmm.
Like, someone's gonna look at it and be like, well, that looks like crap.
Mm-hmm.
And you're just like, you know, I can't show.
Yeah.
Like, yes, my mom will watch the movie and be like, oh, I loved it.
Yeah.
You know, my dad will look at it and be like, I'm so proud. This
mm-hmm.
is the best movie. This is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
And you're just like, well, that's just what parents say.
Right.
You know, and you sort of psych yourself out and you're just like, no, this is a terrible film. I can't
right.
release this.
Yeah.
You know, people are going to laugh at me. But then you sort of, there's a point where you sort of get over that and you're just like, you know what? Like, whatever. This isn't going to be the only movie that I make.
Mm-hmm.
So, I really am proud of how we made it. And
mm-hmm.
so I you know, I keep thinking in the back of my head, like, this idea of George Lucas, who, you know, I love Star Wars, and I respect it, but he did go back and kept changing the original Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
You know, every time there was a new release, there was
mm-hmm.
like a, this animated
maybe
scene here, or whatever,
yeah.
so,
mm-hmm.
because the technology allowed him
right.
to, and I remember realizing at a certain point, it's like, we gotta stop tweaking this movie, because it's never going to be perfect.
Right.
There's always going to be improvements.
Mm-hmm.
And we just need to let it be what it is and learn and then make the next movie better.
Right.
You know?
Right.
If I keep tweaking it, then I'm never going to learn.
Yeah.
You know? And then you sort of get nostalgic and romantic about it and you're like, well, yeah, that was a time capsule of where we were as filmmakers
mm-hmm.
and where the industry was when
yeah.
we made that movie.
Totally.
You know? And I feel the same way about you know, watching any movie that I loved watching as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you watch with adult eyes and you're
mm-hmm.
like, oh, it's a little cheesy. It's maybe
yeah.
not the best movie, but then you realize, but you know, at the time those were the best effects
right.
that they had at
right.
the time, or that's what they could afford.
Yeah.
And because the technology is better now, that doesn't take away from the magic that is that movie in that time and space when it was made.
Right.
So, you know, you sort of go through this whole sort of like emotional roller coaster when you're making a movie.
Yeah.
But it just reinforced this idea of I'm not gonna try to make movies, because there was a point between the Western and making Searching for Fortune, and even after Searching for Fortune, looking for the next movies,
mm-hmm.
and thinking about it in a completely a very backwards way,
mm-hmm.
like not thinking, well, what movies do they want to see? Do they want to see? The distribution company want to see, or the Sundance Institute, or whatever
mm-hmm,
it is,
mm-hmm.
you know, but rather, what movie would I watch?
Mm-hmm.
What movies do I want to make?
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
And you have to have a very honest conversation with yourself.
Yeah.
Like, you know, do I want to make coming of age stories? Do I want to make family dramas? Do I want to make comedies?
Mm-hmm.
Do I, you know, and then ultimately realizing, well, no, the movies that I love, I love genre movies.
Mm-hmm.
I love movies with an edge. I love, you know, thrillers, at least right now,
mm-hmm.
like,
mm-hmm.
you know, so those are the types of movies that I want to make. I also love comedy,
mm-hmm.
So trying to really reflect that in
mm-hmm.
what our next movies are. And it's also a way to, you know, the only way to have a genuine voice is to just be genuine about it,
yeah.
you know?
Yeah,
like,
you can't force.
Right. And even someone, it's funny, because like people talk about someone like Michael Bay, right? And
mm-hmm.
they're like, oh, well, you know, he just makes popcorn movies. It's like, yes, but he makes really damn good popcorn movies.
Right.
He makes the best popcorn movies.
Right.
You know? And maybe it's not, you know, super heady,
mm-hmm.
you know, but they're fun,
mm-hmm.
you know? And, or maybe they're not your cup of tea. That's okay. They don't need
yeah.
to be your cup of tea.
Right.
You know,
somebody's
like,
cup of tea.
Yeah. Tyler Perry is somebody that I have tremendous respect for, because
mm-hmm.
he built a whole studio himself with his name on the wall.
Mm-hmm.
He makes his movies. He knows what his audience is,
mm-hmm.
and he makes profitable movies, and is able to make movies for himself.
Right.
You know, they're not for everybody.
Right.
But that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
Like he's very successful doing that,
mm-hmm.
and that there's nothing wrong with that. That's
yeah.
amazing. Like
yeah.
that's the dream.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, having those conversations. And then also, like, working with my twin brother,
mm-hmm.
having those conversations with him, saying, well, what movies do you want to make? Because I know that they can be different,
mm-hmm.
and that's okay,
yeah.
but they can also be the same, and that's
mm-hmm.
also okay.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, in the movies that we want to collaborate on, you know, what movie would you watch? I would watch this movie. Okay, great. Let's write that movie. Let's
yeah.
make that movie.
That's cool.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's what's next,
yeah.
you know, is, you know, I think we have to have, you know, as many irons in the fire as possible,
mm-hmm.
because, you know, maybe we'll meet somebody tomorrow who'd be like, hey, I'm looking for a zombie movie. Great.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect. We got, you know.
Yeah.
Or like, you know, maybe they'll say, hey, you know, I have all this money and I just need to spend it in Venice, Italy. I'm like, perfect. Great.
That's a
dream. We can go to Venice.
Yeah.
We have a movie.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Cool. this is a silly question, but as someone who doesn't work in the industry, what's the difference between a director and a producer?
That's really interesting. So the director, this is a long answer. All my answers are long answers. In independent film, the producer literally does everything.
Okay.
So the I guess the short answer is the director is sort of like the captain of the ship.
Okay.
They're the ones who are, you know, they're working with the actors, and they're keeping the story in mind,
mm-hmm.
so that they can tell the complete story. They help dictate shots. I mean, and they use everybody to help them. You
mm-hmm.
know, the cinematographer to make sure that they have the shots that they need.
Mm-hmm.
The script supervisor to make sure that the shots make sense, or that the actors
mm-hmm.
are wearing the appropriate clothes
right.
from what we shot yesterday, if
right.
it's supposed to match, all
right.
that kind of stuff. They rely on the lighting team to help light and
mm-hmm.
wardrobe. And
are they the ones that are hiring all these people? Or
no, so the producer, So the producer does all the other stuff that's behind the scenes.
Got it.
So and there's a bunch of different types of producers.
Okay.
There's an executive producer,
right,
who can sometimes just find the money.
Mm.
There are line producers who just deal with hiring the crew and getting the equipment and the logistics.
Got it.
But in the independent film world, the producer will often, and a lot of directors in the independent film world help produce. So like for our movie, Joe helped produce, and did some of the producerial stuff. But we're also, I think because we come from the crew side, we don't like taking credit, taking a title for something that we're not actually doing. So so he was like, I don't want a producing credit. He wants the directing credit. The director can be more creative than the producer in a lot of ways. And there are creative producers, and Mandy and I also helped Joe with a lot of the creative stuff for the movie as well, because it was just the three of us making this. So so literally going from figuring out, okay, well, what bathrooms can we use at this location?
Mm-hmm.
We gotta either rent porta potties or knock on a store and ask them if we could use their bathroom.
Right.
Where are we gonna get lunch from?
Yeah.
How many crew can we afford?
Mm-hmm.
What are we gonna pay the crew?
Yeah.
How do we get this equipment out there?
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
That's what the producers do.
Got it. Okay. Interesting.
Yeah.
It's so funny because you see the credits, you're like, there's a lot of people on this, and I don't know what
they're
this
right
means.
And there are a lot of producers, and sometimes people get a producer credit for, it's like, you know, it's like, well, we have this tiny movie, but I can get you Johnny Depp, so I want a producer credit.
Got it.
You know, a producer is basically anyone who brings something to the table in a lot of ways.
Got it.
You know, for certain things, and then there are like actual producers who do the logistics and they sort of manage the whole film.
Yeah.
You know, and they take it all the way through post production, and then also to delivery, so to getting it out into the world and you know, finding it at home,
right,
selling the movie or whatever it is.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's the difference between
cool.
the director and the producer.
Good to know.
Yeah, and it's always changing. You know, like the you know, if you watch some older movies, it's produced by this one person.
Mm-hmm.
You know, produced by Saul Zance or whoever.
Yeah.
You know, and then there are movies where you have like three screens full of producers,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the definition, I think, is very fluid, especially now.
Yeah.
Because there's no, and especially with technology, there's no longer a right way. And I firmly believe this. There's no right way to make a movie.
Mm.
There are certain standards, but again, a lot of those standards. Also depend on what you can afford.
Yeah.
You know, like,
yeah.
You know, a friend of mine just sent me a short film. It was a test. He made a green screen test with his granddaughters.
Okay.
And it's this beautiful little 3-minute short film. You know, he shot it on his little digital camera.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a legitimate film, even if he didn't have a producer or call sheets or a budget or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, what is to say that film doesn't have the same merit that a big Hollywood film has, you know? So to me, there's no right way to make a movie.
Mm-hmm.
You know, which means it's kind of the Wild West sometimes.
Sure.
But at the same time, there's a beautiful freedom, you know, in that.
Yeah. There's so many places to put it now too. So.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I mean, and I'm just amazed at, you know, this is gonna make me sound like an old man, but man, kids these days, they have it so easy. You know, like you have this is a complete movie studio in my pocket.
Totally.
I can shoot a movie, I can edit it,
yep.
and I can get distribution right here.
Mm-hmm.
Like that is
amazing.
That's
kind of scary.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But then that also means that, well, I have no excuse.
Yeah.
I have a movie studio in my pocket, and I have no excuse.
Yeah.
I should be out there making movies every single day, and I'm not. So, like,
you also have a 1-year-old.
Well, yeah, I know. Like, that's just me being lazy, you know,
yeah.
if I want to. And you know, I mean, go on YouTube, go on Vimeo, and look at some of these amazing films that high school or elementary school kids are making, and you know, I'm just blown away. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, yes, even though there's a lot of crap out there, I have a lot of like hope for the future. Mm-hmm. Like, you know,
yeah,
it's so cool.
And it seems to come so naturally to them. Mm-hmm. Like, it's just so easy for them to make a movie on their own.
And like my brother and I, we had a little video camera and we made movies all the time. Mm-hmm. When we were kids.
Right.
You know, so that's, you know, that's, I think that's just what you do when you find a passion like that. It's great now that there is technology available so that these kids can do more than we were able to do at a younger age and get a better quality product out of it.
Right.
You know, I think it also helps legitimize. Joe and I were very fortunate. Our parents were extremely supportive of us making movies and going to film school.
Right.
You know, it's not like it wasn't like your typical like, no, you should go to business school so you can, you know, get a real job that has, you know, health insurance and benefits and stuff.
Make movies on the side.
Right. So our parents were incredibly encouraging.
Yeah.
And, you know, and let us buy a video camera and, you know, let us make our movies and stuff.
Yeah.
And with the technology now, you know, some teenager in high school, you know, could be making a couple little movies or little, you know, fake commercials, and then, you know, go through college and gets picked up by an ad agency and could be making giant, huge, you know, commercials and, you know, have a very successful career. Like, that is a legitimate path that, that people can take now.
Yeah.
And so I that to me is just, that's so cool.
Yeah.
Like, that's awesome.
Yeah. I have 3 more questions. One that might come off of that. So with that, is college even necessary?
I think it depends on the person.
Okay.
A lot of people have very strong feelings about film school, about undergrad film school versus grad school versus having to go to film school in general. Mm-hmm. Honestly, the best thing, the most valuable thing that you learn in college isn't necessarily what you study. It's things like time management.
Mm-hmm.
It's dealing with and working in like group projects, group settings with people that you like, but more importantly, people that you don't like.
Yeah.
It's learning, you know, there's so much that we go through as human beings from high school into, you know, being young adults, you know, by the time you graduate a 4-year college, that there's a lot of growing up, you know, like, you know, you would go to the parties in college, you know, I can't do that now, you know, like my body can't handle that, but you have to, there's not even like a rite of passage, but there's a lot of growing up that you have to do that has nothing to do with what subjects you're taking.
Mm.
The other thing too, that is, I think, incredibly valuable in college is the ability to choose what you study. I remember being so excited because, you know, you have to take your general ed. I went to San Francisco State and had a blast there.
Mm-hmm.
And you take your general ed classes, you know, like your English and your maths and sciences. But you can choose which science you want to take or which math or whatever it is, and you find something interesting. And I remember going back to my Aunt Sissy, who's a teacher, and there was some family party or something my freshman year in college, and she was like, "How's college?" And I'm like, "I'm loving it. I love like some of the classes that I'm taking." And she said, isn't it such a big difference to be able to choose the class instead of being told you have to study the subject?" And so that, I think, is a powerful thing that, you know, psychologically happens to us when we're, you know, going from adolescence into adulthood. This power that you have of choice. You know, if you miss out on that, then you start your job and you're always working for somebody else. In college, you have you know, you're working towards this end goal, but you are the one choosing the steps that you're taking. You know, whether it's perceived or real choice. You know, I still think it's important developmentally as you know, as you move into the workforce and become a productive member of society.
Yeah.
For the film industry, it's not necessary.
Mm-hmm.
I know a lot of people who either didn't go to college or went to college for something else and wound up in the film industry, especially
mm-hmm.
on the crew side.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people don't realize that they can go to film school, or and I think that there is something valuable about going, learning about another subject, because you make very few movies about making movies.
Mm-hmm.
Movies are all about telling stories and finding interesting subjects.
Right.
You know, that's not about making movies.
Mm-hmm.
You're doing, you know, you're telling a story about an immigrant trying to get home,
mm-hmm.
or
mm-hmm.
you know, a family during World War II,
mm-hmm.
or a historical event, or you know, something else.
Yeah.
And it's hard to write about something that you don't know. That's why a lot of people say, you know, write what you know.
Yeah.
So if you go in and you become an anthropology major and you study, you know, tribes in the Amazon or
mm-hmm.
something,
mm-hmm.
then you find that really, you can make a documentary about that, or even a narrative film about that, because
mm-hmm.
you know you have
right.
so much information.
Yeah.
So it's not necessary at all, but there are some benefits to going to film school,
mm-hmm.
especially going to grad school. Joe and I were lucky because we both knew that we wanted to make movies. So we decided to go to undergrad, and we had a lot of fun. But we were also some of the few people from our generation at SF Stage who are still working in film.
Mm.
But I know a lot of people who went and studied something else and then found grad school, and there's a lot of great benefits, especially now if you're a film student. You know, access to equipment, discounts
mm.
on things people don't, you know, to make your film.
Right.
So it's a good, and it's a good safe environment to make the mistakes,
mm-hmm.
to learn, to try doing sound. Oh, I don't like sound. Try doing lighting. Oh, I don't like lighting. You know, it's a good way. It's a good place to sort of try all those things, without feeling like you have to start over and without have to worry about, you know, making where my next paycheck is gonna come from.
Right.
So. Yeah. So is it necessary? I think it depends on the person.
Yeah. Is everything in life.
Right. Yeah.
The other question is, for me, having worked in sports, I can't go to a sporting event, particularly like in marketing and sponsorship, without noticing everything in
mm-hmm.
the stadium. So like where they place their different signs and, you know, which sponsor is where and what kind of sponsorship
right.
is it. Nobody else does that. That doesn't work in my field. So for you that, you know, works in film, can you watch a film and not critique it?
Yes. Okay. Critique it. The short answer is no, but that bothers a lot of people that I know
mm-hmm.
that work in the film industry.
Mm-hmm.
They watch a movie and they're like, oh, I can't because I see how they did it, I know how they did it.
Mm-hmm.
To me, that's the magic
mm-hmm.
of it, because I've always known or wondered how they did it. I remember Joe and I were watching, I forget who it was with. It was like Andrew or somebody, one of our friends that went to elementary school with. And we were watching Indiana Jones, I think. And I was like, oh yeah, that's so cool that it's on a dolly. And I remember Andrew, or whoever it was like, how do you know it's on a dolly? And I was like, well, I don't know that it's on a dolly, but I'm assuming because it's flat and it's not moving that fast
mm-hmm.
and the height of it,
mm-hmm.
it's probably not, maybe it's on a truck, but I don't see any dust from the truck. Or
mm-hmm.
and so I've, but that never took away from the magic of watching the movie
yeah.
for me.
And
it
enhanced it.
Yeah, and to this day it still doesn't. I often, Joe and I try to watch a lot of movies as inspiration, you know, during the writing process.
Yeah.
And I'll start a movie saying, okay, I'm gonna watch, like for the zombie ambulance movie, there's a strong badass female lead.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, okay, great, I'm gonna watch Alien.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect.
Yeah.
You know, I want this character, she's our Ripley. Okay.
Yeah.
I started watching Alien. Okay, I need to pay attention, I need to learn something. All of a sudden the credits roll and it's the end of the movie and I have popcorn and I'm like, oh crap, I forgot to take mental notes. I just, you know.
You just enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or I'm watching it, and I'm like, how did they do that? I gotta rewind. How did they do that?
Mm.
How did they... I don't know how they did it. Okay, all right. I gotta figure out how they did that. That's so cool.
Yeah.
But it's never, you know, it doesn't bother me. Mm. It doesn't bother me that that I think that way. It doesn't take away... It enhances it.
Yeah.
I still love it. I can sit down and enjoy a movie, and, you know. It's not even... I don't even have to turn my filmmaking brain off. I just, you know, it's a struggle for me to keep my filmmaking brain on so I can take notes and say, mm-hmm. oh, maybe I ought to try this.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe I ought to, you know, to try to learn anything from watching the movie.
Right.
That for me is a struggle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. any advice for people that want to get into film?
Yeah, just... yes, just do it.
Yeah, like you said, they have no excuse.
Right, like, okay, you have to be proactive, you have to, especially in the film industry,
mm-hmm.
I mean, that's like any job, though, you have to love it, because you're working long hours, you're not getting paid a ton, there's not a ton of benefits, you can make more money getting more sleep, with better benefits and have more time off if you did a regular 9-to-5 job.
Mm-hmm.
And there's nothing wrong with that. Mm-hmm. A lot of people like that. I have work, that stays over there. I come home, this stays over here.
Mm-hmm.
They're separated.
Right.
That's totally fine.
Mm-hmm.
There's some times that I envy that.
Mm-hmm.
I take my work with me wherever I'm working right now.
Yeah.
And, you know, like... I never have a break. It's hard for me to take vacations. My wife hates it. Like, it's hard for, she needs to take a vacation from work, and I'm like, no, I can't take a vacation, because that means that I'm not working, that I'm just wasting time. I'm getting older by the day, and I have all these movies I need to make, you know? So in my head, I'm like, well, okay, I'm not taking vacations. I'm going on scouts. That's how I justify it.
Yeah, or just, like, getting inspired.
Right, and I know. I know that I do need to unplug sometimes, but
sure.
You know, why would I need to... A producer friend of ours told us once, like, you know, my life is a vacation. I don't need to take vacations,
mm-hmm.
you know, because I'm doing what I love. And that is so true.
Yeah.
Like I love making movies. I'm still waiting for somebody to call. I live in fear that somebody is going to point me out on set and be like, you would do this for free, wouldn't you? What are we doing paying you?
Yeah.
Wait, they feed you and they pay you to make movies? That's so cool.
Yeah.
You know, but it's long hours, you know, like minimum 12-hour day, plus I have to get up, I have to get all my stuff together, I have to drive to the location, I have to be early, I have to, you know, the shot's running late, so we go past 12 hours, you know.
Right.
It can be grueling.
Mm-hmm.
It can be unpredictable, you know. You don't know if the TV show you're working on is going to come back for next season.
Right.
You know, if you get hurt, you cannot... go to set and work,
right.
You know, you break a leg, it's not like you have, you know, unless you're a member of a union and have enough to get those benefits,
right.
You know, you're on your own insurance, you know, you have to be proactive,
mm-hmm.
you don't know where your next paycheck is going to come from, so you have to text people and call people and say, hey, I'm available for work, you know, and, you really have to have passion, or you'll get burnt out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I know that the day that I come home from set, I'm like, because I've had some rough days on set
mm-hmm.
where I'm like, man, this isn't fun. But I don't think I've ever come home and thought, I gotta find a new job.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think the day that I do that is the day that I give up making movies.
Right.
Because you have to have fun doing it,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
But it's, you know, you don't have weekends, you don't have